Today we're talking about Donald Trump's Supreme Court nominee, because he's been dragging out this announcement process like it's the opening to The Bachelor. I wonder who he's gonna give the first impression rose to. Turns out, it's Brett Kavanaugh, a young white conservative. Who could have guessed? So, let's get to know the guy who will participate in interpreting the next generation of US laws. The main through line in his opinions working as a judge for the district court is that he stands against expanding administrative agencies' authorities. Well, that sounds boring yet important. Basically, right now there are a ton of really ambiguous Supreme Court rules. I mean, if you listen to this show regularly, every week there's a major decision that seems like it should have been addressed maybe a week after we founded this country that's just now getting addressed. Anyways, the court generally does this thing called Chevron deference, and this justice hates that. Here's Mike Crapo. Oh man, elementary school must have been hard for you, with more.
Judges defer to policy decisions of executive agencies, as Chevron calls for. Those decisions depend largely on the public or the policy preferences of the agencies.
Basically, if there's ever an ambiguous ruling, and believe me, there are plenty, we still don't definitely know which guns the Second Amendment protects, we defer to the agency to determine what to do. It should come as no surprise that when you leave an agency to regulate itself in a gray area, it never finds itself saying, "Well, this regulation says we can, but this one says we can't, so we probably just shouldn't do it." Guys, this is why our Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency is active in 46 damn countries. Well, no one told us not to, so we just decided to slide our agents all over the world. Instead, Kavanaugh believes in what he calls the major rules doctrine. Boo! That sounds like so much less fun. Now, this is similar to Justice Roberts' thinking in that if there's ambiguity, look to Congress. And if Congress didn't assign you to do that thing, you can't become an overachiever and just start doing it. Although, this is where him and Roberts disagree. Roberts says that if you really want to do a thing, you have to go to the courts to get permission instead of just saying hashtag YOLO. Kavanaugh, on the other hand, says that, well, you don't have a permission slip from Congress, so your argument is invalid. That may sound great, but it gets controversial when...
What we know is that he's skeptical of federal agencies and believes Congress should be writing regulations. In recent years, that view's manifested itself on him rebuking Obama-era rules like the EPA's greenhouse gas rules, the FCC's net neutrality rules, and the structure of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau.
Yeah, net neutrality was the FCC just hashtag YOLOing over ambiguous regulation rules, as well as the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and most EPA actions. And with Congress being Congress, yeah, those agencies shouldn't be expecting any new assignments anytime soon. So now to the big one that I'm sure everyone is thinking about, Roe v. Wade. This is one where Justice Kennedy's absence might be felt. So blue states, prepare to be feeling a little bluer soon. Oh man, abortion. This is such a hard topic to write jokes about. I can hear the crickets already. Anthony Kennedy was the swing vote in a very important abortion case for this generation, when Texas was putting on burdensome, expensive, and unnecessary regulation on abortion clinics. Now, some of you might object to my wording there, but that's not me, that's the Supreme Court, so let's not shoot the messenger. Anyways, looking at this case, Kennedy's swing vote said that shutting down these clinics was putting an undue burden on women looking to exercise their legal right to have an abortion.
In another decision, we have now seen a controversial Texas abortion law overturned here. Jan, it had been called the most important decision regarding abortion in a generation. What to make of it?
Although critics say he could have just easily said, abortion isn't a right, and sided with other Republican justices in making it so that the anti-abortion laws in this country don't have to be so subtle, and instead can have the nuance of a stop sign. So clearly, Kennedy helped the cause. But what does this Trump nominee think? Well, I actually had to rewrite this part because I thought that he'd have a radical stance on this. First, in a case regarding whether an illegal immigrant in a detention center could have an abortion, he said that the government had conceded the teen's right to an abortion. Now, that might sound radical, but it's just evidence that he heard of Roe versus Wade. Furthermore, he said during his district court confirmation hearing that he'd respect precedent on abortion and declined to share his views on Roe v. Wade. So, like, alright, he understands and respects constitutional precedent, despite the fact that that's kind of what half of the Supreme Court justices' job is. Wow, alright. Despite that, most people think he's gonna vote to overturn that precedent. Because, well, identifying unconstitutional precedents is the other half of the Supreme Court justice's job. Also, that's probably true considering that was pretty much the most important criteria for being Trump's judicial nominee. And the fact that you can tell from his writings that he's personally not a fan, using terms like abortion on demand. Interestingly enough, he ruled similarly on a religious freedoms case. Unlike other dissenters who maintain that there is no compelling government interest in facilitating access to contraception, Kavanaugh would have ruled that a compelling interest does exist, but the government can achieve it in other ways. Again, this isn't the most radical stuff in the world, but compared to the Supreme Court nominee some had built up in their head, essentially a 14th century priest who thinks that the Dark Ages is the perfect level of government regulation, he does seem to be, at the bare minimum for liberals, rational in his decision-making. Next, Kavanaugh seems to be passionate about enabling the government to detain enemy combatants. I'll just put it this way. If you want to claim habeas corpus or government Fourth Amendment violations, well, I hope you're watching this video a year ago, because that case might not be winnable for the foreseeable future. Actually, I said that and then realized, well, that's just not true. Because while you can't look to Kavanaugh for support, Justice Roberts was a swing vote and more left from Kennedy when it came to the Fourth Amendment protections of tracking our phones, and he's still there. So criminals, that's the guy you have to impress. One last thing, Kavanaugh is consistent on presidential power. He liberally uses Article 2 of the Constitution to declare independent agencies like the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau to be unconstitutional because they infringe on executive power. Although, have you met this president? Between Trump University and all those failed Trump-licensed real estate investment opportunities, we might need that agency to protect us from him. He also thinks that Kavanaugh views the very independence of the Consumer Protection Safety Commission, the Federal Election Commission, the Securities and Exchange Commission, and many dozens more as an unconstitutional infringement on the power of the president. One major belief of his that people are reporting on is that he believes that the president cannot be held accountable on criminal charges until he is impeached or voluntarily steps down. Like, it's a radical belief. But it's the status quo. And widely accepted. The radical piece he brings to this part of the debate is the incredibly specific detail of thinking that the president shouldn't be taken to civil court for things not related to the presidency. Something that generally wouldn't be such a big deal. But again, have you met our president? He gets sued so often I'm surprised he has free time to do things that he ends up getting sued for. This is where his thoughts on executive power get controversial though. Because he wrote that Congress should give back to the president the full power to act when he believes that a particular independent counsel is out to get him. Yeah, he thinks that the president should have the power to fire an independent counsel if that counsel is out to get him. Which, gee, I wonder why he used that wording. Well, he got nominated, so it worked. Can't wait to see witch hunt become a legal term. I did an entire episode about this, and it does get confusing, but suffice to say, because independent counsels work for the Justice Department, which is a part of the executive branch, this isn't actually as radical as it sounds to some people. It gets into the whole argument of independent counsel being an inferior officer, and, well, it's still up for debate. His last controversial opinion, and my god is this a good one to end on. To be sure, the president has the duty to take care that the laws be faithfully executed. That certainly means that the executive has to follow and comply with laws regulating the executive branch. Well, that's not too controversial, although that to be sure is the I'm not racist but of the judicial world. I'm sure the second half of his statement is just as reasonable as the first. At least unless the president deems the law unconstitutional. in which event the president can decline to follow the statute until a final court order says otherwise. And there we go. What could go wrong there? So this has been taken out of context with the express idea of a medley of wanting more clicks and wanting to scare the heck out of Never Trumpers. What he was talking about was the Take Care Clause of Article 2. You know, the one that says the president shall take care that the laws be faithfully executed. Well, his interpretation of that is that the president can choose not to prosecute certain illegal activities, citing it as an extension of his pardon powers, along with President Jefferson choosing not to prosecute censorship laws in 1801. So, it's not as though he thinks the president can make the lying New York Times illegal until the Supreme Court hears oral arguments and releases a well-written decision 5 months later. That's still a pretty radical interpretation, especially because, again, that line says that the president shall take care that the laws be faithfully executed. That's really hard to say is up to interpretation. Anyways, Justice Kavanaugh, I'll probably see you in court. And, as always, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. And as always, thank you for watching.